In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same was in the beginning with God.
He said unto them, Go ye into all the world, and preach the gospel to every creature. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved, but he that believeth not shall be damned. And these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, they shall speak with new tongues, they shall take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover.
Though our sins are scarlet, you've made us white as snow. Though our sins are scarlet, you've made us white as snow.
Look out, devil, here we come. Hold on just a minute. Brother and Sister Mulling, we are so honored to have you here tonight. Let's give them a great hand. We give honor to your district superintendent and his precious wife. And also Brother Cantrell and his dear wife is here tonight. Let's give them a great hand. And Brother Claiborne, Brother Smith, Brother Morton, and this entire youth committee, I think they deserve an arousing applause. They're awesome. You folks are going to make me run out of things to preach. You know, one of the things that a youth camp preacher really works on is you don't play sports harder than you worship God in church. I saw some guys getting it on the court today, but they've been getting it around these aisles. I like that. That tells me you're not out of juice. You're on fire! I'll tell you what, Jesus likes it. Now, some of you played hard, you prayed hard, and now you worship hard. Guess what? It's the second half. How many is ready to have a red-hot apostolic demonstration of the Holy Ghost and fire? Oh, hallelujah. Now, one more time, let's put our hands together and worship Him. Clap your hands, all you people, and shout, hallelujah! The book of Hebrews, chapter 11. Book of Hebrews, chapter 11. This music has been absolutely wonderful tonight. We thank God for it. Great job, choir. Book of Hebrews, chapter 11, verse 24. By faith, Moses, when he was come to years, refused. Turn to your neighbor and say, he refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to enjoy the pleasures of sin. Somebody say sin for a season. Here's my favorite scripture right here. Esteeming the reproach of Christ greater riches than treasures in Egypt. For he had respect unto the recompense of the reward. By faith he forsook Egypt, not fearing the wrath of a king, for he endured as seeing him who is invisible. My, it's like we can almost see him tonight. The presence of the Lord is mighty in this house tonight. They tell me there's three types of people. They say there is the futurist. And the futurist is threatened by his past. He goes into his future thinking he doesn't need his past. And then there is the preservationist, that he fears all change to be compromised. And so he never moves beyond where he is. But then there is the transitionalist that realizes the only way I can survive in my future is to carry my past with me. I'm not preaching about a sinful past. I'm preaching about a holy past. We can't go into the new millennium unless we take some old paths with us. I said we can't go into a new millennium unless we're willing to take a holy heritage with us. I want to preach about it tonight. I simply want to title it, When Moses Grew Up. When Moses Grew Up. I want us to lift our hands and ask God to let His perfect will and way be in this house right now. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, thank You for Your Word. Thank You for Your power. Thank You for Your goodness. Thank You for it, Lord. Not by might and power, but by Your Spirit, confirm Your Word with signs following. In the name of Jesus. Now let's clap our hands one more time and get ready for what God is going to do in this house. Hallelujah. Let's clap a little bit more, one more time. Hallelujah. Jesus is in the house. Anything can happen. Get ready. Expect it. Anything can happen. God bless you, and you may be seated. Beloved, when I gave all diligence to write unto you of the common salvation, it was needful for me to write unto you and to exhort you that you should earnestly contend for the faith which was once delivered unto the saints. I don't know if you have realized it here tonight, but we have been given a holy heritage. And it is a heritage worth living for. And it's a heritage worth dying for. And it's a heritage worth fighting for. And I don't know about you tonight, but I've made my mind up. I'm glad to be a one God apostolic tongue-talking holy roller that's been baptized in Jesus' name, full of the Holy Ghost, that believes in separation from the world. This is not the time to give up, to give in, to retreat, or to back up. It's not time to look for easy believism, but it's time to make up your mind. I want the old path. Wherein is the good way? You know what I'm finding out at youth camp? Young people don't want it dry. They don't want it dead. They don't want you to beat around the bush. They want to know. You can't preach it hard enough at youth camp. You can't preach it straight enough to a generation of hungry young people that's about to turn their world upside down. Oh, I'm telling you, that back of intimidation is broken. I can feel it. The devil is trembling tonight because he knows he's in the presence of a group that's made up their mind. I'm not looking for an easy way. Come on, I want to preach to you tonight. It took suffering to get us to this point. It took fasting to get us to this point. It took prayer to get us to this point. And you talk about cashing in, that in. No way, friend. It's worth fighting for, and it's worth contending for. Be seated just a moment. My old grandfather was not a preacher, but he was a preacher's friend. And when he heard that his 18-year-old grandson had a call to preach on his life, he said, "Come here, honey. Grandpa is diagnosed with cancer. But let Paul Humphrey tell you something. I hear that you have declared openly that God has called you to preach." He said, "Now, Paul's dying with cancer." He said, "But I've got something to tell you today." He said, "Sit down in that lawn chair and that big 6-foot-4 frame and big old hands that didn't know anything but roofing and building barns and hard work. That's all he knew. He took those big hands and he placed them on top of mine. And when he got them there, suddenly there was a trembling in his hand. And he began to shake all over his body. And he said, "Let Paul tell you something. What you have gotten into and what you have received, you are going to walk in vineyards that you didn't plant. And you're going to walk in houses that you didn't build." And he said, "Son, let me just tell you something. If God has called you to preach, don't you dare be a playboy. You be a preacher." He said, "Now, Paul is not a preacher, but I love preachers, and I love preaching. And I don't want you to compromise, but I want you to hold the banner high. I'm not going to meddle in your pastor's business tonight, but God has ordained this preacher to tell you, you don't need to create a pew pressure to make your pastor feel that you don't want it. But when you go home next week, you need to say, 'Pour it on. Give it to me straight. Don't let up. Preach like you've never preached.' We're ready to see the dead raised. We're ready to see the blind see." You may be seated just a moment. This is not the hour. This is not the hour to put pressure on your youth pastor to give you more entertainment than he does prayer meetings. Come on, I'm not going to preach to you like children because you're acting like adults. I'm going to preach to you like adults tonight. It's time to get as excited about a prayer meeting as you can about a pizza party. I said it's worth living for. It's worth dying for. It's worth giving everything you've got. You may be seated. Some of you have said this in your own mind. "Well, if I wasn't living for God, I'd be doing this. And if I wasn't living for God, I'd be playing this. And if I wasn't living for God, I'd be making this." Well, I'm telling you, You better get to the place where you can say, I don't care how much I can make, and I don't care how much I can play, but if I can just be in the church, if I can just feel what I'm feeling right now, it's better than a job. It's better than a career. It's better than playing sports. It's better than anything. Heritage. You may be seated just a moment. Heritage. I feel tonight that I am preaching to a group of young people that is rich in heritage, and to whom much is given, much is going to be required. And Moses, just a baby, was placed in an ark, drifted down the river, didn't know where he would end up. He was found by Pharaoh's daughter, and she took it, and she needed a nursemaid. And so momentarily he was placed back into the hands of his own mama, long enough for heritage to leave an indelible mark that he would never be able to escape. Long enough for a heritage to get deep down inside of him. Now, he wasn't a lad of a boy, because the great historian Josephus said this of Moses, said that Moses, and I had never heard or read anything like this in my life, but Moses was responsible for leading the armies of Egypt into battle against Ethiopia, and so crippled them that they have not risen unto this day. And so he had some successes under his belt. He had some talent. He was able. He was a warrior. He had all of the signs, and he had a kingdom that he would be getting in just an amount of time. He was heir. He would be heir to the throne. He had all of the riches that Egypt had would be his. He had so much that was coming to him. But in the course of just an ordinary day, as blood began to pump through his heart, all of a sudden, Moses, when he came to years, in the course of an ordinary day, something happened. Now, if Josephus is right, and if that is true, and that's the way I'll preach it tonight, if that is true, then that even makes it more reasonable that she would lay claim to him. Evidently, she got to the place to where she was saying, "See, old Moses, I got him out of the river. He's mine. He belongs to me. That's my boy. See how talented he is? Look at him. See how strong he is? That's my boy. He belongs to me." And one day, Moses got to hearing that, and something got a hold of him. And I mean, way down deep, heritage began to speak louder than her dominating voice. It said, "Wait a minute, Moses. You're not an Egyptian. Moses, you're not an Egyptian." And heritage took over. And he said, "Wait a minute. I refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter." Somebody here tonight at this youth camp on a Tuesday night, the old devil's been laying claim to you. "That's my boy. That's my girl. See how strong she is. See how talented she is. See how able she is. She's mine." But somebody is about to get angry, and you're going to remember the heritage that is inside of you. "I refuse to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, the voice of her taking control of him was more than he could stomach. I wish somebody here tonight would say, devil, you pain me for the last time. What is the purpose of this service tonight? I'll tell you what it is. It's an absolute commitment to live for Jesus Christ like you have never lived for Him before. Be seated just a moment. And then it'd be just like the devil to tell you, well, Moses, you better look around before you make such a blatant statement. Look at all the suffering that your people's going through. Look at what is happening among your own ranks. You sure you want to join up with that bunch? Moses, are you sure? And Moses was so sure that heritage had gotten so loud that he said, I would rather suffer with the saints. You know what? I believe in healing like I've never believed in it before. But there's some precious old-timers that have been diagnosed with cancer and their body has been melting away. And a little old young preacher walk in a hospital to cheer them up. And here's what they say. Well, I've been living for God for 40 years now. And you know, I didn't expect to go out this way. But you know, honey, He's never done anything to me but good. And I love Him more today than I've ever loved Him in my life. Be seated just a moment. I may be taken with cancer, but let me tell you about the visitation I had the other night. She said the presence of the Lord walked in here so strong. And Brother Mullings, while we go to try to encourage them, we get encouraged because they made their mind up. I'd rather suffer in the church. Come on! Everything's not been healed. Everything's not been delivered. But they stayed right on in the church. Moses said, I'd rather suffer in the church than stay here. I'd rather suffer with the children of God. I'd rather go through affliction than enjoy the pleasures of sin for a season. Be seated just a moment. Somebody's going to make up their mind tonight. I'd rather suffer with saints than sin with my buddies. Somebody, I've got to preach what God's given me. I'd rather suffer in the church. I'd rather go through what I'm going through than listen to that rock and roll and that rap junk. You can call me holy virtuous if you want to, but everybody's not doing it. I said everybody's not doing it, and everybody's not going to do it. Come on, young people, help me preach. Everybody's not going to do it. Somebody's going to make up their mind. I'd rather suffer than sin. I'd rather suffer than sin. No. Yeah, I know sin is pleasurable, but it'll send you to a red-hot hell. But let me just preach on this a while. You had never had pleasure until you started speaking in a heavenly language. You had never had pleasure until the power of God got all over your body. You had never had a good time. You had never been drunk. You had never been high. You had never been free. Come on. Don't you brag about your heroin. Let me brag about my Jesus. Oh, yeah! He can bring you out, but he can keep you out. Here's the part I want to preach. Esteeming, loving, craving, reverencing the reproach of Christ. And some of you precious young ladies decorating your uncut hair have had your head down, walking. But when Moses grew up, I esteem the reproach of Christ. No, I'm sorry. We can't join the ranks of everybody that calls himself Christian. I'm sorry, we can't do it. We'll never do it. We can't do it. We won't do it. We're not going to do it. Because they want to take away the reproach. But I esteem the reproach. Call me what you want to, but I'm glad I've got holiness in my heart and I've got holiness on the outside. You let them laugh at your hair all you want to. You let them make fun of it, but put your shoulders up and say, I'd rather suffer. Call you a Bible-toting sissy, but the real men are not ashamed. I feel like we're going to have a revival of gang members after this youth camp like we've never had, because some of you are going to go out with holy boldness. Thank God for my reproach. If somebody says, ha, 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 look at that Pentecostal, you ought to go hallelujah. Ha, 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 hallelujah. Ha, 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 hallelujah. Call me what you want to, but one of these days, the dead in Christ are going to rise first, and then we which are alive and remain are going to be caught up together to meet them in the air. Stand to your feet. I'm through. I'm quitting. My God. That's why this generation's going to have revival. You're hungry. I said you're hungry. You're thirsty. The Holy Ghost is about to fall like rain in here. Moses got out of Egypt. He got on the backside of a desert. And God started getting Egypt out of him. Do you know why? He said, Moses, now that you've made up your mind, I'm going to place you in a position where I can prepare you to go back to that influenced you and influence it. You ever heard that before? I said the reason, when you make up your mind, I'm coming out of Egypt and I'm going to let my pastor and Jesus get Egypt out of me. The only reason God wants to do that is because he wants your feet to go back into Egypt. Let me qualify it now. Some folks, you got to qualify everything. Let me qualify it. You're not going witnessing in bars. You're not going to the basketball games to witness. But you're going to tear your high schools upside down with apostolic revival. Woo! Apostolic revival. Because he's getting Egypt out of us. and the pure apostolic fire of the Holy Ghost is going to fall like rain. If you believe it, start praising Him right now. That's it. You're going to create the downpour. Your worship right now is going to create the downpour. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. Some of you are already thinking about what you're going home to destroy. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I'm coming out. I refuse. I refuse. I refuse. That's it. Grab somebody by the hand and say, let's get out. That's it. Go ahead. There's going to be a revival of drug addicts like you've never seen. There's going to be a drug addict revival. There's going to be a gang member revival. Yes, 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 yes. Go ahead, young lady. Fall in love with the reproach. Fall in love with the reproach. You can't preach it hard enough. You can't preach it long enough. You can't preach it straight enough. Right now, let the Holy Ghost fall. Let it fall on you. Let it fall on you. I'm growing up. I'm getting out. Yes. Kiandara Laboho Satala Bahaya. Kikayando Laboho Satai. For the mouth of the Lord has declared it. Go ahead, everybody, pray with somebody right now. Everybody, pray with somebody. Preach to me, Pastor. Preach to me. I want revival. I want to see my friends saved. I want to see them delivered. I want to see them born again.
Oh Lord,
listen to me, young
God,
people. God doesn't just want to do a 500-soul revival in one church. He wants to do it in every church across this state.
The worlds thy hands have made. I
some of you young men
stars
that's been wrestling with Egypt.
I hear
would
the
you just
rolling
say, excuse
thunder.
Me. I gotta get
thy
to the
thy power
front.
Throughout. The universe display.
Some of you that have been feeling Egypt trying to hang
then
on to you.
Then sings my
just
soul,
say,
my
I
Savior
to
God
front.
To
I want
me.
A preacher to take his hand
how
and
great
put on my
thou
head.
Art.
I'm coming out.
How great thou art.
All right, young
then
ladies,
sings my soul, my Savior God to
me. Get ready, the wind of the Holy Ghost wants to breathe
how
across
great
this
thou
audience
art.
Right now. Young lady, if you're
how
restless, press your
art.
Way to the front and raise both hands. Come on, quickly, quickly, press
when
your way.
When through the woods and forest blaze
I
wander, and hear the birds
day.
Sing sweetly in the trees.
All right, hands raised all over the building.
When I look
love
down
him with everything you've got in your heart.
From lofty mountain grandeur, and hear the brook, and feel the gentle breeze. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when I think that God, his Son not sparing, sent him to die, I scarce can take it in. That on a cross
my burdens gladly bearing. He bled and died to take away my sin. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. And when Christ shall come, with shout of acclamation, and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art, how great thou art.
Jesus, the name above.